What's up, y'all? Today, we're going to explore the Workspace browser in MATLAB and also talk about some commands we can use to manage MATLAB variables. Let's jump right in by declaring a selection of MATLAB variables. Let's start with the default variable type in MATLAB, which is a numeric variable known as a double precision floating point number. Don't worry about all that, only that if I set x equal to 31, one of the things that's really interesting over in the workspace, we've already seen this, we can see that there is now a variable x in the workspace whose value is 31. If we right click on that workspace bar, MATLAB will ask me, what type of data would you like to see associated with that variable? In this case, I'm gonna go ahead and tell MATLAB, I wanna see the class or the data typed used to encode that information. Remember, every variable is a symbolic name, an assigned value, and also a storage location in memory. In this case, MATLAB is indicating the assigned value is encoded using a special map known as a double or a double precision floating point number. Don't worry about any of that, but I did want to show you, I can also do x single, and I can set that equal to the single version of the same number. Notice that I am typecasting. I am telling MATLAB to store the value using a different encoding. We could also do x unsigned integer. We're going to talk a lot more about that in future lessons. And maybe we do what we call an 8-bit encoding. So we'll do x is an unsigned integer with 8 bits. And its value is 31. Notice the same value is stored, but here we have different types of information. We could also do a 64-bit encoding. So we'll call this x unsigned integer 64 bits. The value of each of these variables is identical, even though the class, the data type, the rules I am using for encoding the assigned value into the associated space in memory are different. We could continue our foray into this. Let's do a signed integer, and we'll do it with 32 bits. Don't worry about anything that I'm saying at this moment in your history in MATLAB. We're gonna dive very deep into all these different data classes in a later portion of our work together. The point of this is to show you that there's more than just the variable name, the value stored, and also the location in memory. There's also these rules that determine how do we actually store these numbers. We could also do what we call an example character variable. In this case, MATLAB stores character by using the single quotation mark. So perhaps we say this is an example character. MATLAB will then create a variable associated with this, and the data class that we're using in this case is char, C-H-A-R, which means character. We could also do an example string, and in this case, we're gonna use the double quotation marks, and we'll say this is an example string. Here, we notice that in our workspace, we've now declared a bunch of different variables. We can see the assigned values, we can see the class. We can also see the size of those variables if we'd like. Notice here that the character array is a 1 by 29. That is because this string has 29 characters. In other words, the character data class encodes letters in such a way that each letter has its own entry in our array. Notice, on the other hand, the string data class is a 1 by 1, meaning this entire string is stored as a single unit, because the string is actually kind of what we call like a structure. It's used to encode bits of language, sentences, et cetera, et cetera. We're not gonna worry about any of that at this moment. I just wanna kind of highlight the different features of the workspace that we can work with. One really interesting thing about the workspace that we mentioned earlier is that the default setting, when I go ahead and declare any variable, let's go ahead and say y is equal to negative 31, if I don't tell MATLAB what type of data I want to encode, MATLAB automatically defaults to the double precision. Another thing that's interesting is all MATLAB variables are stored as arrays. In fact, we saw that in a previous video. If we did format debug, and then we get in type y. Notice that the number of rows in this particular array is 1. M represents the number of rows. N represents the number of columns. That's also 1. Wanted to show you this because if I go back to the workspace and double click on y, that's going to open what we know as the variable browser. Let me go ahead and undock that so you can see it. What's really interesting about this is this will tell me the location of the individual entry. In this case, the 1x1 entry has 31, but I could actually edit and manipulate the value of y by typing in entries here. So now I'm gonna go ahead and say that y is now a 1x2. Let's go ahead and keep filling this out. Let's say maybe this is 5, negative 32. And let's do something exotic. Let's put in the row 3, column 2, let's put a 0 and see what happens. Did you notice that? MATLAB automatically populated the entire matrix associated with that as 0. Let's go ahead and close this. When we look back into our workspace, notice that double-clicking on the individual entry and manipulating the corresponding coefficients in this variable browser changed the value of my variable. Now this is a 3x4 double, and the size is 3 rows by 4 columns, each of whose entries is a double. If I go ahead and type y again, notice that in this case, the format debug tells me different address and also different row and column dimensions. M is no longer equal to N. The value has also changed because I've manipulated that value. In other words, anytime we go into the workspace and double click, when we change the corresponding entries in this variable table, let's put a 1 here and maybe a 64 down in position 6. When I go back to my workspace location down here, this was x, uint. Notice that I haven't finished this, but if I push the tab button, MATLAB will give me all variables that begin with the same letters. In this case, I wanted to choose the 64-bit encoding because that's the one I changed. So let's go ahead and double click on that. Notice MATLAB has updated this information with what I typed in by double clicking. And I see that this variable represents an m=6 by n=1 array. In other words, it's a 6x1 column vector. The point of all this was to show you there are many ways to manipulate MATLAB variables. One of those mechanisms is to type into the command window. Once variables sit in workspace, we can actually manipulate and change this value. Let's go ahead and click on the string and see what happens. Notice, indeed, MATLAB is an array-based language because the array is actually an array of strings. Here is another string. And yet a third example. Let's see what happens in a matrix of strings. If I close the variable editor, notice that MATLAB is showing me the command associated with the changes that I'm making in the workspace. And if I were to view the eg_, if I push tab, this will give me all the variables that start with eg_ stored in the workspace. Let's go ahead and click on string and push enter. This says that it is a 2x2 string array. Here are the entries. So these are a bunch of different strings that are stored in that array. Remember, the point of this video is to show us how to manage variables in MATLAB. One way we're seeing how to do that is to use the workspace itself. Another way to do that is through the command window. If I type the command who, H-W-O, as in who am I looking at, MATLAB will produce for me a list of variables that I've stored in the workspace. If I were to maximize my command window so that I don't see the workspace, this would allow me to see all the variables that I've stored. Similarly, I can type the who with an S at the end, so whose, This will not only give me the names of all the variable stores, but also different information above and beyond the name. So this is what I would call a generalization of the who command that gives me more specific. It gives me the size of the variable, the number of bytes used to store that in memory. A byte is 8 bits. We'll talk more about that in a later video. Also, the data class used to store that in memory. Don't worry about data classes right now. I'm showing you this as a way to get you thinking, wow, there's more going on with variables than I thought. As we see, who and the generalization or bigger brother, whose, are both commands that I can use to print lists of stored variables in the command window. Let's pretend that we wanted to now delete some of those variables. String is a large one. Look at how large, how many bytes that stores in memory. One way to do that is to go up to the workspace and then right click and then push delete. Are you sure you want to delete? Yes, MATLAB, I'd like to delete. Notice that eg underscore string now disappears. If I type whose, similarly, that variable is no longer in my workspace. It has disappeared from memory. Another thing we saw is if I typed the clear command and then let's do eg character, that would get rid of the variable eg underscore character. I can also do this if I put clear x uint, and then this is kind of interesting. If I push star, MATLAB will interpret that star as anything following the initial x underscore uint. So in this case, I have two variables that follow the same structure at the beginning, x underscore uint. This is saying, MATLAB, please clear all variables that have that start. And if I push enter, I want you to focus your sight up here, claim, the moment I push enter on this command, the two variables that start with that prefix are gonna disappear. Here we go. Did you see that? Those both disappeared. Let's now pretend I want to delete all variables starting with X. If I go clear X star, that says to MATLAB, please find all variables that start with the letter X, and then no matter what comes after that, delete it. Notice all variables that started with X are now gone from my representation. I don't have enough variables in memory to make the next command that I'm going to do interesting. Because of that, I'm gonna go ahead and just copy and paste all the variables that I declared previously, and then push enter. That gets everything that I had started with back into memory. Notice I could put clear, and it will delete my entire workspace. All variables that I had stored now disappear. Let's rerun that block of code, all those variable declarations. In this case, I'm gonna go down to my command history, highlight all of the variable commands that I want, right click, and then put evaluate selection. What's that gonna do is run through each of those lines of code individually and declare them. Notice my workspace is full again. Let's go back into the command window, and this time we'll push clear all. That is yet an equivalent way to delete all things in the workspace, either clear or clear all. If you're noticing that this is kind of a nice mechanism to delete information from MATLAB's workspace, one thing that I would encourage you to do is to type help clear. This will produce a documentation overview of how clear works. There's some cool things that you can see here. For more information, you can click on the documentation page associated with the clear function, and that will bring up in documentation this information. One highlight I want to show that we haven't yet talked about is that in the documentation, we have this small description. In this case, we see that the clear function is designed to remove items from workspace and free up system memory. The reason that this is important is when we look at the syntax, the different ways that we call the clear function, we can actually see that there are many different ways to call this. We've seen the first one, which is to clear all memory. The second one says clear the name of variable one, the name of variable two, all the way to as many variables as you'd like, removes the variables, scripts, functions, or MEX files. We're not sure what an MEX file is at this stage in our coding career. But what we're seeing here is that clear, the function clear, actually does a lot of things that are more than just variables. We've only worked with variables at this point, so we're not sure what it means to clear a script file or a function file yet. But the point is that the clear function does a lot more than just manipulate variables and delete them from MATLAB's workspace. I want to scroll all the way down to this. There's a lot of documentation here that you can read as you get more sophisticated in MATLAB. And I want to highlight the C also section of this documentation. Notice that there's the CLC command. We've already kind of talked about that for clearing the command window of previous commands. There's also the clear vars and delete import load mlock whos. We talked about whos previously. Let's check out clear vars or clear variables and see what the difference is between the clear function and the clear vars function. So let's go ahead and click on that. That brings up the documentation, and notice the clear vars function is to clear variables from memory. Let's go back and look at the clear function. What's the difference between clear var and clears? Well, clear removes items from the workspace, freeing up system memory. Let's go back down and go to clear vars. In this case, we'll open it in a new tab. And then let's put that new tab right next door so that we can compare the two documentation. Notice clear removes items from the workspace. Clear vars removes variables from the workspace. So it looks like clear is a function that does more general work to get rid of stuff that's stored in the workspace, whereas clear vars is specifically designed for variables. The other thing that we've mentioned about documentation is there are some nice examples that allow us to figure out how these work. In this case, if we looked at the first example in the clear documentation and compared that to the first example in the clear vars documentation, they actually look pretty similar, meaning the clear vars command can be used similarly to the clear command. Where they differ is in the lower categories of examples, and that's where getting into documentation can really help me as a coder figure out which function is most appropriate for which particular application I'm hoping for. We'll end this video with a quick recap of what we've just done. We've talked about commands that we can type into the command window to manage the MATLAB workspace or manage variables and other items that are in MATLAB's memory. Here is a recap of those: who, which tells me what variables are stored, the names of them, the symbolic names of those variables; whose, which is a generalization or the long form of who that also gives a detailed list associated with everything stored in the workspace. Then we had clear, which gets rid of everything regardless of what it is, and then clear with the names of the specific items that we want to delete. We also saw that we can do a lot with the workspace by actually going into the workspace browser and then clicking on individual variables that are stored so that we can manipulate them that way. As a final challenge to the viewers, I'd love it if you comment in this video resources that you found that describe why being an array-based language has a competitive advantage for MATLAB. I have compelling answers for this that I'll talk about later in our series. But for now, I want to see you all do some searching. Can you find resources that describe in detail why MATLAB having arrays, matrices, as the base data class makes MATLAB more competitive as a platform for scientific computation? If you find good resources on that, please do it in the comments. I'm always looking for good descriptions on why that's true. Thanks a lot, y'all, and I'll see you in the next videos.